Hello, good day. Welcome to this class. We'll be talking about emergency management of poison. This is the outline we will be following. To poison means to injure or kill with a substance or a xenobiotic, that's any substance that's foreign to our not natural or normal organic existence that is known or discovered to be harmful. Thus, the term poisoning connotes clinical symptomatology. It also implies that the toxic exposure is unintentional. For example, the case of an elderly patient who misreads a drug label. In contrast, the term overdose implies intentional toxic exposure, either in the form of a suicide attempt or as inadvertent harm secondary to purposeful drug use. The terms poisoning and drug overdose often are used interchangeably, especially when prescription drugs are the agent. Even though by definition, a drug overdose does not produce poisoning unless it causes clinical symptoms. In Nigeria, the drugs that have been found to be culprits in most of the poisoning cases include some of the following: paracetamol, amitriptyline, clofazimine, ferrosulfate, and then there's some other compounds like kerosene, organophosphate. A popular example of organophosphate is tapiapia. Then there's carbon monoxide poisoning, which is of course very common because of the use of portable generators in Nigeria. Now, most of these poisoning incidences are common in childhood and elderly patients, but overdose has an incidence that's a bit stable throughout adulthood. Now, the general approach of managing poisoning has a few phases that we'll also be essentially looking at throughout this lecture. Stabilization, laboratory assessment, decontamination of GIT skin and eyes, administration of an antidote, elimination and enhancement of the toxin, observation and disposition. Now, quickly, we run through emergency management. Because overdose patients are often clinically unstable when discovered, resuscitation with establishment of the airway, adequate support of ventilation and perfusion, and maintenance of all vital signs must be accomplished first. Continuous cardiac and pulse oximetry monitoring is essential. Now, in some patients, you will require rapid sequence intubation. This is especially important in patients who may be in jeopardy of aspiration because of the nature of the toxin that they have swallowed. Now, maintenance of blood pressure and tissue perfusion may require provision of volume, correction of acid-base disturbance, administration of a pressor agent, and antidote therapy. Now, there's a list of some of the common antidotes which you will find in your notes, you will see that once you get into and once you get to see the main notes. Okay. You see a few examples on this slide. For example, for paracetamol, the specific antidote is N-acetylcysteine. For benzodiazepines, you have clomazenil. For beta blockers, you have glucagon. Calcium channel blockers, you have calcium chloride. Now, let's really talk about advanced airway management. And this is important in those patients who, for example, you need complete airway control. You need to protect them from aspiration. You also need to provide routes for suction and optimize oxygenation and ventilation. Now, in addition to basic airway management, many victims of poisoning require advanced management that includes endotracheal intubation. Clinical situations in which this may be necessary are numerous. Intubation offers the advantage of complete airway control it protects patients from aspiration of dusty contents when they are vomiting. It provides a route for suctioning of secretions as well, and a means of optimizing both oxygenation and ventilation. However, the process of intubating an awake patient is difficult and associated with potential adverse effects, including coughing, gagging, vomiting, and then a host of other side effects, for example, hypertension, hypoxia, increased cranial pressure. Moreover, emergency intubation can be challenged by vocal cords that are obscured by secretions, unusual airway anatomy, a full stomach, or active vomiting. Therefore, this task requires a thorough understanding of advanced airway management principles and their application in a manner that prevents worsening of the clinical situation. For rapid sequence intubation, it has to follow this specific sequence, from preparing the patient to drug administration to intubation to post intubation management. It is very important. Now, it is most commonly useful in head trauma patients, but of course, in patients who may have been exposed to corrosive toxins, it's also useful in such cases. Now, these are some agents in which rapid sequence intubation may be necessary. The patient has been exposed to corrosive ingestion, corrosive inhalation, envenomation, anaphylaxis, pulmonary edema, then they require rapid sequence intubation. And some of the drugs used in pretreatment, sedatives and anesthetics, skeletal muscle relaxants that are useful in helping ensure that rapid sequence intubation works are listed on the screen. Some of the equipment also required for the procedure are listed: syringe for endotracheal cough inflation, 100% oxygen, face mask, bag valve apparatus, suction equipment, catheter, the stylet, manual forceps, oral airway, and then, of course, for the size of endotracheal tube size, that for the age specified. Of course, in some patients, you may find that the sizing may vary, but you know, this is a general size. Now, let's quickly look at circulatory support. Circulatory support. Poison patients often present to the emergency department with hypertension or frank shock. Now, in this patient, provision of circulatory support through interventions that can, you know, help sustain perfusion is important. So for them, you have to provide circulatory support, including volume expansion, vasopressor therapy, antidote administration, and correction of electrolyte and acid-base balance. Okay. Now, many medicines and toxins produce hypertension. But this also depends on the ingested substance, right? The low blood pressure may have a number of causes. For example, blood pressure depressions may occur due to direct depression of myocardial contraction. An example of a drug that causes that is spinidine, can be caused by disturbance of central nervous system cardiorespiratory center. Clonidine causes that. Severe GI fluid losses. Paracetamol causes that. Peripheral vasodilation, for example, ACE inhibitor, or a combination of some of these effects. Calcium channel blockers does that. And then theophylline is also another common example. Now, hypotension can result from the secondary effects of toxins. For example, cocaine-induced myocardial infarction. Finally, blood pressure disturbances in the poison patients may also represent accompanying trauma. For example, severe spinal cord injury or internal hemorrhage. With a multitude of possible causes, you must, you know, on the basis of the known pathophysiology of a particular drug, and after having done thorough physical assessment, You should determine, if at all possible, the probable cause of hypertension in that patient. These are some examples of intoxicants that are commonly associated with hypertension. For pharmaceuticals, you have alpha antagonists, you have ACE inhibitors, barbiturates, calcium channel blockers, clonidine, digoxin. For metals and minerals, you have arsenic and iron. For endenominations, you have silentarates and scombroids. Those are marine organisms. And reptiles. And then for chemical weapons, you have ricin, that's the nerve gas. Now let's see what cardiovascular support through volume expansion entails. Appropriate cardiac output, of course, we know cardiac output is stroke volume times heart rate. Through this basic calculation, we understand that cardiac output depends on adequacy of intravascular volume. After poisoning, intravascular volume may decrease abruptly. This decrease can be absolute, for example, when there's direct loss of intravascular volume. For example, if the patient is suffering from pulmonary edema or there's pooling of blood within the GI. And it can also be relative. For example, it can result from severe peripheral vasodilation severe peripheral vasodilation caused by ACE inhibitors or alpha antagonist overdose, you'll find that intravascular volume reduces. In either case, hypertension should first be treated with the administration of a volume expanding agent. This is the first protocol, administer a volume expanding agent. Many fluids are acceptable for emergency volume management. So for example, normal saline and Ringer's lactate solution are generally the most available isotonic agents. Recall that these are, crystalloid solutions. So after administration of the bolus, this patient should be reassessed for improvement in cardiac output. Alternative fluids that can be used for volume expansion in a poison patient include albumin and whole blood. Each of these fluids has a role that is best determined by the pathophysiologic mechanism responsible for the hypertension. Being colloids, that's albumin and whole blood, being colloids rather than crystalloid in nature, these fluids will maintain intravascular volume better than saline solution. In clinical solution, for example, in clinical situations, for example, where you have a leaky capillary syndrome, where there is mechanical, where the source of intravascular volume loss is mechanical, the use of colloid solutions may be preferred. Whole blood is most valuable in solutions in which there is frank blood loss. Okay, for example, there's an injury and there's blood loss from the patient. Now, usually, the adequacy of volume expansion is determined clinically by an increase in blood pressure. So you watch the patient for increase in blood pressure. You also watch for resolution of cyanosis, normalization of capillary refill time. Okay, these are important because you may not be able to directly measure any other parameter, but at least you can measure blood pressure. You can ensure the patient is on continuous measurement of blood pressure, right? And that will also help you identify. And another thing you must watch for is fluid overload. It's a potential complication of volume expansion, and it most likely occurs in patients who receive excess fluids over a short period of time. Now let's look at vasopressor therapy. This is the second stage. Now, if volume expansion does not work, you include vasopressor therapy. In patients with severe hypotension, vasopressor therapy is necessary. If blood pressure is not satisfactorily improved after volume expansion, Vasopressors are drugs that can be administered to maintain cardiac health. These agents have specific effects on the heart or blood vessels by augmenting myocardial function or increasing vasomotor tone, or by doing both of these. With rare exception, vasopressors used in acute management of hypertension are short-acting drugs that are given by IV, continuous IV infusion. Now, vasopressors usually generally act as adrenergic alpha and beta, dopaminergic, or glucagon receptors. The adrenergic system has been further defined with the recognition of two major alpha adrenergic receptor subtypes, alpha 1 and 2, and three beta adrenergic receptor subtypes, of course, beta 1, 2, and 3. Coupled with intracellular G proteins, these membrane-bound receptors effect an intracellular chain of events that includes changes in the activity of adenylate cyclase. This action goes on to modulate the level of intracellular cyclic adenosine monophosphate, CAMP, which in turn alters phospholipase activity or opens gated calcium channels. Although the cellular mechanism of this system have become much better defined, the general principles of vasopressor action remain unchanged. For example, alpha adrenergic receptor agonists produce vascular smooth muscle contraction. Beta 1 adrenergic receptor agonists produce increased heart rate and contractility, whereas beta 2 adrenergic receptor agonists promote generalized smooth muscle relaxation, including bronchial and vascular relaxation. Vasopressor therapy is designed to improve cardiac output through manipulation of the specific receptor most appropriate for the clinical situation. A number of vasopressors can be used to provide blood pressure support. See the next slide. I will quickly run through a few examples. Now, very commonly used is epinephrine. Epinephrine elevates blood pressure primarily through its alpha adrenergic stimulating property. This effect is valuable because it improves myocardial and cerebral blood flow. Now, that means it improves perfusion of critical organs during injury. Because it also has prominent beta adrenergic agonist effect, epinephrine is variably effective at producing max increases in blood pressure. Epinephrine therapy is usually initiated at the dose of 0.1 to 0.5 micrograms per kg per minute. Epinephrine is particularly effective in intoxications associated with hypotension and bronchospasm. Now, norepinephrine stimulates both alpha and beta adrenergic receptors with slightly greater stimulation of alpha adrenergic receptors. The effect is improved vasomotor tone in conjunction with increased myocardial tonotropy and inotropy, meaning the heart rate, the force of contraction of the heart, and the rate at which the heart also contracts is increased. Norepinephrine infusions are typically initiated at a dose of 0.1 to 0.5 micrograms per kg per minute. Now, another important one is dopamine. It's a precursor of norepinephrine and is the most popular of vasopressors. Dopamine appears to have at least three mechanisms of action. It promotes norepinephrine synthesis that has a tyramine-like effect that stimulates release of preformed norepinephrine, and it also directly stimulates vascular dopamine receptors. The cardiovascular effect of dopamine is also variable depending on the infusion rate. At relatively low doses, the drug dilates renal and mesenteric vessels without marked increases in heart rate or blood pressure. At doses of 2 to 10 micrograms per kg per minute, beta adrenergic receptor stimulation predominates, producing significant increases in cardiac output. Finally, at doses greater than 10 micrograms per kg per minute, alpha adrenergic receptor stimulation is the primary action, resulting in marked peripheral vasoconstriction. The general dose range for dopamine use is therefore between 2 to 20 micrograms per kg per minute. Dopamine is safe and effective for any type of drug-induced hypertension. In the past, there have been theoretic concerns that dopamine's beta adrenergic effect in the case of phenothiazine or tricyclic antidepressant intoxication would increase the peripheral vasodilation associated with overdose, exacerbating hypertension. However, Experimental data and clinical experience have failed to confirm this adverse effect from dopamine use. Okay, so it's been relatively used safely. Okay. Even though some research has shown that after monoamine oxidase inhibitor overdose, dopamine's effect are somewhat unpredictable. So it should not be used or should be used with care following monoamine oxidase inhibitor overdose. With that, we'll go on to talk about antidote administration. Now, administration of antidotes and electrolyte imbalance, we will talk about that in a couple of slides forward. Let me skip that in the meantime. Let's quickly talk about clinical evaluation. Following cardiovascular support, it's important to begin to provide a clinical evaluation for the patient. And this is done in three steps. Clinical evaluation, thorough history taking, physical examination, and assessment of major signs of toxicity. So thorough history taking and physical examination are essential to diagnosis of the toxic patient. Reason being, poisoning should be suspected in any patient who presents with multi-system disturbance until proven otherwise. Although the initial manifestations of poisons are plenty, you know, you can't really pin them down to a single symptomatology. A patient with acute poisoning often presents with coma, cardiac arrhythmia, seizures, metabolic acidosis, GI disturbance, either together as a symptom complex. Okay, these are some of the symptom complexes, as you can see. Now, these symptom complexes or toxicity may give a clue to an unknown poison. For example, patients with history of depression who present with coma, seizures, and widened QRS complex or evidence of dysrhythmia on ECG and dilated pupils has likely taken a tricyclic antidepressant overdose. Hepatic, renal, respiratory, and hematologic disturbances are generally delayed manifestations of poisoning as well. In clinical evaluation, in addition to history taking, you should also include an assessment of major signs of toxicity presented by the patient and evaluation of laboratory data. Let's take a look at medication history taking. Now, when one suspects poisoning or drug overdose, primary goal of history taking is identifying the toxic agent. Sometimes the diagnosis is easy. For example, in the case of a toddler who has ingested iron tablets in the mother's presence, you know what the patient is taking. And sometimes it may be difficult. For example, a patient who is hiding a history of drug abuse and passes out at work, or who has an unexpected seizure, you know, prior medical or psychiatric history, current medications and allergies should be obtained from family or friends if the patient is unable to relay that information. For example, if they are unconscious, or if they are uncooperative. Some of the questions you can ask are listed on the screen. What other medicines are in the house? What was the patient doing when they passed out? Does he or she live alone? Did he or she just lose their job? Have there been recent emotionally traumatic events? You know, all of those questions to arrive at useful identification of the toxin. Now, in terms of physical examination, it's important to pay a lot of attention to this, since physical examination can help in determining the extent of poisoning and may also reveal the presence of a toxic syndrome, you know, of an underlying disease or even concomitant trauma. Repeated assessment, especially of vital signs and of cardiac, pulmonary, and neurological status, is critical to proper management of the toxicologic patient. Now, let's quickly look at what should you look for. Vital signs, as part of initial evaluation, complete determination of vital signs, including measurement of body temperature, initially and throughout the emergency department assessment is mandatory. So you should obtain core body temperature, hyperthermia, for example, can occur with the number of injections and also in infectious illness. But it is also a character of poisoning with salicylate, anticholinergics, monoamine oxidase inhibitors. It is occasionally also seen after intoxication with benzocaine, LSD, or cocaine, especially following a seizure. Life-threatening malignant hypothermia following drug overdose may occur. Hypothermia is also common and can occur because of exposure to cold, hypoglycemia, or overdose of a number of sedatives, especially barbiturates, ethanol, carbamazepine, narcotics, and phenothiazine. Bradycardia can also be seen with overdose of digitalis, cholinergic agents, beta blockers, and calcium channel blockers. Now, let's quickly take a look at the skin. Now, what should you look for on the skin? Skin should be examined for needle tracks, burns, bruises, or lacerations. Of course, needle tracks may be confined to the groin or other areas that are not readily visible, especially for those who are hiding their drug use. Now, a reddish appearance suggests ingestion of boric acid containing roach powder insecticide. For those who may have swallowed powder insecticide in attempts of suicide, you might see generalized flushing will suggest an allergic reaction. Could also be due to niacin overdose or anticholinergic poisoning. That's also very common. And also, if the patient has taken, for example, metronidazole and consumed alcohol, you know what is called alcohol disulfiram reaction? Yes, that may also happen. Now, diaphoresis may suggest hypoglycemia, salicylate or organophosphate poisoning, hyperthyroidism, drug or alcohol withdrawal, or even shock from cardiac or other etiology. Jaundice may appear if the patient has taken an overdose of paracetamol, aspirin, iron, or carbon tetrachloride, or has even been exposed to poison by mushrooms. You might notice jaundice on the skin or in the sclera of the eye. You may also see lesions on the skin. You may see lesions on the skin or soft tissue swelling. This should prompt evaluation for rhabdomyolysis. It's an occasional finding in patients following prolonged coma or severe hypothermia, such as in cocaine abuse. So these are some of the things you should watch out for on the skin of patients when they present. Okay, another important physical examination is breath. It's important to smell the patient's breath. Alcohol is the most common odor detected on the breath of an intoxicated patient in the emergency department or on presentation. The accurate identification of other odors varies greatly. A fruity odor may be detected in patients with diabetic ketoacidosis. Cyanide poisoning can be associated with the smell of almonds. Smell of cleaning fluids suggests carbon tetrachloride poisoning. Gasoline, that's petrol, camphor, hydrogen sulfide, phenol, organophosphate insecticide all have their own characteristic odors. Of course, when you're trying to identify to be sure it's organophosphate, for example, tapioca, you know, most people use kerosene as a vehicle for tapioca. So note that you may also get mixed signals from that. Okay, now for ear, nose, and throat, nasal examination may reveal chronic insufflation of cocaine. An edematous, often elongated uvula may be seen with marijuana use or exposure to corrosive agents. That those are very important, especially in the identification of cocaine overdose. You might still find some bits of you might find some bits of the powder either hanging on the air in the nostrils or around the nose. For lungs, basically, auscultation of the lungs may provide diagnostic clues. In opioid or tricyclic antidepressant overdose, pulmonary edema can usually be recognized on auscultation. In all overdose patients, aspiration pneumonitis, the result of depressed gag reflex, is a possibility. So interpretation of lungs examination may be tricky. Pneumothorax may be detected in patients who smoke cocaine, methamphetamine, or any other heated impure substance. In terms of the heart, if you examine the heart, of course, you may hear a new murmur, which in an intravenous drug abuser suggests endocarditis. Bradycardia is common after overdose of calcium channel blockers, beta blocking agents, digitalis, and central alpha 2 agonists like clonidine. A ventricular arrhythmia on ECG in a young patient will usually suggest cocaine toxicity. And in terms of the abdomen, if the abdomen feels hard and like a board, with a patient that has had a history of spider bites, you should be thinking of black widow spider envenomation. Examination of the abdomen in an overdose patient often reveals an adynamic ileus. In patients with abdominal pain, a surgical abdomen must be ruled out because that's an emergency situation. Hepatomegaly may suggest liver congestion in such patients. In terms of neurological assessment, all patients should undergo careful neurological assessment on presentation. Issues of major concern are concomitant head trauma, spinal cord trauma in comatose patients. Serial neurological and neurologic examination are key to proper assessment. So in that, you look at level of consciousness and other things, which we'll see shortly. Extremities. The extremities should be evaluated to detect thrombophlebitis. Now, fracture or dislocation may also be identified, or vascular insufficiency. Rhabdomyolysis and the compartment syndrome are definite concerns in overdose patients, especially in those with prolonged coma or underlying trauma. Now, let's quickly see what it looks like. This is the symptom complexes we talked about earlier. These are non-toxic ingestions. They are defined as non-toxic because they produce little to no toxicity when taken in small amounts. Okay, so some of these are things that people commonly report to you that they've swallowed, and you can easily reassure them and send them back home as long as there are no symptoms to suggest poisoning. These are also important cues that can track on physical examination. Like we mentioned earlier on, if you see little traps, especially in hidden parts, for example, in the flexor of the elbow, in hidden areas, sometimes even in genital areas, that may point to intravenous drug abuse. Someone who's trying to hide their intravenous drug abuse. Characteristic odor of breath, you can have gasoline. We talked about this earlier. Now, under assessment of major signs of toxicity, let's quickly talk about level of consciousness. These are very important. The toxicologic patient presenting in the in an emergency setting often exhibit some of these major signs of toxicity, either alone or in combination: coma, cardiac arrhythmia, metabolic acidosis, GI disturbance, and seizure. We'll discuss all of these situations shortly. Now, let's first look at level of consciousness, and in a way, we'll also talk about coma, so we'll talk about that. Consciousness is defined as an awareness of self and the environment. Coma is arousable unresponsiveness, while wakefulness implies the ability to be aroused. These three functional states are mediated by the ascending reticular activating system, a tract that runs through the diencephalon, the midbrain, and the pons. Diseases produce coma either by diffusely affecting the brain or by encroaching on the brainstem itself. Now, coma may be produced by supratentorial mass lesion, such as a subdural mass, subdural hematoma, a brainstem lesion, which is uncommon, or can be metabolic disorders that widely depress or interrupt brain function. One of the most common manifestations of acute poisoning is coma. The principles of coma management are relatively straightforward. The patient in coma must be stabilized initially by establishing an airway, proper oxygenation, and then, of course, you continue monitoring with pulse oximetry. You insert an IV line with normal saline to, of course, to maintain volume, and then you initiate resuscitation if necessary. Okay. Now, the clinical evaluation of the comatose patient is invaluable, not only in determining the depth of coma and assessing for trauma, but also in providing a baseline for repeated clinical assessments. Coma can be assessed either using the simple AVPU, alert, responsive only to verbal stimuli, responsive only to painful stimuli, or unresponsive, or you use the more objective Glasgow coma scale. Okay. The major causes of coma in patients seen in the emergency department include poisoning, which is, for example, from carbon monoxide, drug overdose, head trauma, cerebrovascular accident, anoxia, infection, for example, meningitis, diabetes, and other systemic disorders like renal failure, hepatic coma, and cardiac arrhythmia. So the attending physician must, of course, rule out each of these conditions before establishing the diagnosis of poisoning. Supratentorial structural lesions are suggested by a rapid progression of signs, including changes in respiratory pattern, disconjugate gaze, lateralizing signs, or loss of dull eye movement. Okay? A metabolic cause of coma may be indicated by the persistence of the papillary light reflex, a depression of respiration, and consciousness more pronounced than other neurological signs. Preceding altered mental states, asterixis or fasciculations, or both, the presence of a ciliospinal reflex and extracranial signs such as jaundice. Repeated assessment of the comatose patient is critical to proper management of poisoning. Now, when assessing this patient, you may find a few of these very important. The pupils. The patient's pupil is most helpful. Midpoint fixed pupils or unilateral dilated pupils suggest structural lesion. Pinpoint pupils suggest overdose of opiates, clonidine, organophosphate insecticide, or nerve agents, for example, sarin. For eye movements, ocular movements, a disturbance of ocular movement, for example, loss of those eye movements, suggests a structural lesion. Nystagmus suggests intoxication with phenytoin, pencyclidine, carbamazepine, and occasionally ethanol. Respiration. It's important to note abnormal patterns of breathing, because for example, post hyperventilation apnea and apneustic breathing strongly suggest that a structural lesion is the cause of the patient's coma. Central neurogenic hyperventilation is a classic presentation of brainstem injury. Compensatory hyperventilation may accompany methanol or ethylene glycol poisoning or other toxin producing metabolic acidosis. Respiratory arrest is a common presentation in the patients who have taken a CNS depressant and may lead to multisystemic dysfunction resulting from severe hypoxic injury. In terms of motor function in the comatose patient, the corticate and the cerebrate posturing suggest a structural lesion. It's important to realize that patients with poisoning or drug overdose, for example, tetrodotoxin intoxication, may appear brain dead. You may have seen some movies where this poison has been used to make people appear as if they died, to pass, you know, to present them as dead and then they are resuscitated. Okay. Such patients appear brain dead, they are fixed, dilated pupils, they are in an unresponsive coma and lack the cold caloric response, yet they recover fully in time. Now, let's look at another major sign of toxicity, which is okay, let's look at the next major sign of toxicity, which is cardiac arrhythmia. Cardiac arrhythmia is usually evaluated with a 12-lead electrocardiogram, ECG, and continuous cardiac monitoring. These are essential for any patient with significant poisoning. Evidence of an arrhythmia or other important diagnostic clues may be present on ECG, such as widened QRS complex or cyclic antidepressant overdose, or a prolonged QT interval in trazodone or arsenic poisoning overdose. Now, the patient with life-threatening cardiac arrhythmia should be managed on the basis of the general principles of resuscitation and the American Heart Association's Advanced Cardiac Life Support Guidelines. If cyclic antidepressant overdose is suspected, then administration of sodium bicarbonate is indicated for correcting the ventricular arrhythmia or conduction disturbances. Sodium bicarbonate may also be effective in the treatment of other overdose by other agents associated with prolongation of QRS complex, including when it is caused by diphenhydramine overdose or cocaine. Administering IV calcium chloride is a primary therapeutic measure for calcium channel blocker overdose. Using digoxin antibody fragment is indicated for digitalis poisoning. In all intoxicated patients, correction of hypoxia, metabolic acidosis, and fluid and electrolyte disturbance serves to reduce the incidence of cardiac arrhythmias. Some of the common causes for prolonged cardiac arrhythmia includes prolonged PR interval caused by digoxin and other digitalis compounds, prolonged QRS interval caused by chloroquine, quinine, quinidine, and other related compounds, including diphenhydramine. Prolonged QT interval caused by arsenic, cisapride, erythromycin, phenothiazine, pyridazine, haloperidol. Rhythm disturbances, ventricular or supraventricular, caused by beta blockers, calcium channel blockers, carbon monoxide, clonidine, cocaine, and theophylline. Now let's quickly look at metabolic acidosis, one of the manifestations of major poisoning. Now, causes of a high anion gap you know, some of them are listed in the next slide. And that's why you note that assessment of metabolic acidosis includes not only arterial or less ideally venous blood gas analysis, but also studies of serum sodium, serum potassium, chloride, carbon dioxide, blood urea nitrogen, creatinine, glucose, acetone, serum osmolality, and urine pH, as well as urinalysis. So determination of the anion gap is helpful in diagnosis and management of poisoning. You should measure serum osmolality either directly by determining the freezing point or by calculation. The formula is serum osmolality is equal to 2 times sodium ion milliequivalent per liter plus blood urea nitrogen in milligrams per dL divided by 2.8 plus glucose in milligrams per dL divided by 18. Normal range will be between 280 to 295 milliosmoles per liter. Some of the causes of a high anion gap can include alcoholic ketoacidosis, cyanide poisoning, diabetic ketoacidosis, excessive intake of iron, isoniazid poisoning. Okay. When laboratory data are expressed in international SI units, of course, the formula will be different. It will just be 2 multiplied by the sodium unit plus BUN plus glucose unit. Okay. The most common cause for the an osmolar gap is consumption of alcohol. The osmolar gap can be used to estimate the serum concentration of an alcohol based on that alcohol's molecular weight. A substance contributes to osmolality only if it achieves relatively high blood levels and has low molecular weight. Most drugs or intoxicants cannot be detected with use of the osmolar gap. Causes of osmolar gap, diseases or conditions include hyperproteinemia, hyperlipidemia. Alcohols that can cause osmolar gap include acetone, ethanol, ethylene glycol, and then pharmaceuticals like propylene glycol, IV contrast, and mannitol can cause an osmolar gap. Of course, we talked about these and these. Now, let's quickly look at GI disturbance, which is also a major sign of toxicity that you should evaluate in the presenting patient. The causes of GI toxicity disturbance are many. Patients with iron or ricin poisoning has severe repeated episodes of vomiting and may develop GI hemorrhage. Theophylline on its own can cause persistent vomiting, forceful vomiting, while acute lithium and arsenic poisoning produce massive diarrhea. Patients with acute mercury poisoning have a mucus type diarrhea with subsequent development of hemorrhagic colitis. One of the most striking presentations is caused by phosphorus poisoning, which produces luminescent vomitus and flatus. Now, the early presentation of organophosphate or nerve agent exposure is similar to what you find in acute gastroenteritis and is characterized by abdominal cramps, vomiting, diarrhea, with subsequent development of neurologic signs at the later phase. Poisoning from mushrooms, toxic marine life, botulism, and food should be, you know, included in the differential diagnosis. Chemotherapeutic agents have also been shown to cause toxic gastroenteritis. The management of GI disturbance in the toxic patient includes following the general principles of blood fluid and electrolyte resuscitation when indicated. you also use parenteral antiemetics to control persistent vomiting. Special measures such as antidotal therapy in those ones that have specific antidotes, or you do intervention therapy such as charcoal hemoperfusion with, for example, ethiopylene overdose, or hemodialysis in lithium overdose. Now, let's really talk about seizures, the last example of major toxicity. Common agents that cause seizures can include anticholinergics, bupropion, camphor, carbon monoxide, cocaine, insulin overdose, isoniazid overdose, overdose of oral hypoglycemics, and so on. Almost any drug or toxin is capable of producing a seizure. Delayed seizures occurring during a recovery period may be a sign of sedative, hypnotic, or alcohol withdrawal. Seizures should be managed first by establishing airway and oxygenation. Patients with a simple isolated seizure may require only observation and supportive care, whereas patients with repeated seizures or status epilepticus, which can be life-threatening, must be managed aggressively. Some seizures are particularly difficult to control, such as those seen with ethiopylene or those in cocaine overdose. Standard regimen for seizure control in overdose of an unknown agent is full therapeutic dose of benzodiazepine, either diazepam or lorazepam, followed by administration of phenytoin or a barbiturate. In patients with status epilepticus, rapid sequence intubation may be necessary, and the use of thiopental is indicated with electroencephalographic monitoring to ensure control of electrical seizure activity. The use of additional paralytics, such as pancuronium bromide, may be warranted in such patients. You can also take specific antidotes where warranted. For example, pyridoxine can be used in isoniazid-induced seizures to reduce events. Now, let's talk about laboratory evaluation for the toxic patients. Of course, this is important because it will also help either to identify or in management or to establish management in the patient. But it's important, we're going to see some important measures as we go on. In every significant poisoning, routine studies include complete blood count, determination of serum electrolytes, glucose level, BUN, blood urea nitrogen, creatinine, calcium, urinalysis, prothrombin time, pulse oximetry, end-tidal CO2 monitoring, and 12-lead ECG. Arterial blood gas analysis is necessary for evaluating respiratory status and acid-base abnormalities, particularly in the comatose or seizure patient. The measurement of serum salicylate and acetaminophen, that's paracetamol levels, is generally added in the case of the patient with overdose of an unknown substance. Because these agents are often co-ingestants or are contained in combination drugs, measurement of hepatic enzyme is also important in evaluating paracetamol toxicity. The advantage of a toxicologic drug screen in initial management is, however, unclear. There's a partial list of drugs in one of the that are not commonly detected with routine drug monitoring: ITI hypertensives, organophosphates, antiarrhythmics, carbon monoxide, cyanide. Those are not detected during routine, drug panel test like that. So it's important that you do further laboratory blood studies to assess the individual diagnostic and therapeutic needs for the patient. It's extremely important to remember that you should treat the patient, not the lab results. Okay, don't withdraw or withhold therapy while waiting for a confirmatory drug level in a critical patient. For example, in a patient with tricyclic antidepressant overdose, who is exhibiting cardiac arrhythmias, for example, a wide QRS complex. In contrast, you should not also do interventions that are not warranted. For example, you should not perform hemodialysis on a patient that is asymptomatic, just on the basis of one test result indicating that they have elevated serum lithium concentration. That would be unwise, okay? It's also important that your patient should have a serial blood test, and which is helpful in guiding therapy in patients undergoing hemodialysis, and in patients in whom concretions are formed, such as those with barbiturate, iron salicylate, or meprobamate intoxication, or in patients receiving antidote therapy. Okay, serial blood level determinations are helpful. A urinalysis is also necessary. Performing one thing, you should also do a urine pregnancy test for all women of childbearing age, regardless of their status when they come in the poisoning. It's important to identify early on if the life of the fetus may be in danger, in addition to treating the pregnant female. Okay. Urine pH monitoring is helpful in the management of salicylate overdose. Urine is the best specimen to use for drug screening purposes. A urinalysis is also useful in the early identification of acute renal failure or rhabdomyolysis with myoglobinuria. The intravenous drug user requires special blood testing, such as evaluation for HIV, hepatitis B, and blood culture to identify bacteremia, or evaluation for rhabdomyolysis. Chest radiography is also important for diagnosing aspiration pneumonia or pulmonary edema. Okay. Some of the drugs that are radio opaque include chloral hydrate, enteric coated preparations, phenothiazine, and of course, sustained release pharmaceuticals. Some of the metals that may also show up on chest radiography can also include metals like calcium, iron, lithium, potassium, and then foreign bodies like cracked vials and drug packets that have been swallowed can also show up in such chest x-rays. Now, let's look at decontamination. Why do we do decontamination? Usually when people ingest poisons or take an overdose of drugs, you want to, like we said in the beginning, you want to isolate them from reservoirs or storage of those medicines. It's important to do that so that what they've ingested, yes, they're causing harm, but you prevent them from further ingesting more or absorbing more of that toxin so that you can reduce the damage done to them. Of course, the exposure can be directly on the skin, the eyes, can be through the mouth, they can swallow it, okay? So you can do decontamination both, on the skin, you can decontaminate the eyes, you can also decontaminate the GIT. So it's important to note that. For ocular decontamination, water alone is typically employed for initial eye decontamination. Physiologic saline and other saline-based eye washes are often employed for eye decontamination, both in healthcare and industrial settings. The use of this solution has been largely empiric and practical because it is available almost everywhere, rather than because there is evidence for its efficacy. With regard to eye exposure, research has pointed out that water is hypotonic to corneal stroma, allowing edema, to occur and leading to increased penetration of chemicals. So the recommendation is to use amphoteric solutions to avoid these problems. Okay. Recently, there have been new products that have been brought to market, for example, dipoterene, which is an amphoteric solution proposed for use in both acid and alkali exposures of the eyes and skin, with emphasis on immediate irrigation. So it has to be available at the point where the poisoning happens, and it has to be administered between 1 and 2 hours. You know, max. I think the maximum is actually 1 hour after exposure. So it's important that the patient receive treatment within an hour that they've been exposed. So it's not usually for clinical use. It's for use at the site of contamination, right? The other agents that's also available from the same company is hexafluorine, which is proposed for the treatment of exposure to hydrogen fluoride, an industrial chemical. Both of these compounds are indicated for skin and eye decontamination. Now let's talk about skin decontamination or dermal decontamination. The skin is the largest and the most superficial organ in the body. Skin is often subject to exposure to toxins and is usually involved in most reported cases. The effects of exposure can be local or systemic. Because the skin can allow absorption of toxins, okay, you can find systemic toxicity after dermal absorption of aniline dyes, camphor, hexachloroplast, hydrofluoric acid, nerve agents, organophosphate insecticides like papia, you know, phenol, thallium, organic mercury, and others. The skin provides many barriers to the absorption of toxins. The stratum corneum, for example, which is the uppermost layer of the skin, forms an important first barrier and is highly effective when it is completely intact. However, when the skin is wounded, the wounds are wet, and when exposure to a certain highly lipophilic substances, for example, organophosphate insecticides like papia, once it's exposed to even intact skin, significant absorption of the toxin to the skin can occur. And the skin of children is notable for being more permeable than that of adults to substances of all classes. So it's important to note that. The range of dermal toxins is broad. Most of these substances are corrosive agents capable of producing burns that may become full thickness, that's 4-degree burns. Other types of agents are irritants, sensitizers, allergens, vesicants, and exfoliants. Of course, some of them are used in creams and cosmetics for direct application on the skin. How do you manage these dermal contamination? As with ocular exposure, the general principle of management are many. As soon as a toxic dermal exposure is recognized, decontamination efforts should begin. If the victim is immersed in toxic fluid, first step of management is his or her extrication, that's remove the person without injuring, you know, the person. The victim should, you know, pull off their clothes, remove all clothing on their body at the time that they are exposed, and then, you know, do that as safely as possible. Remove all those clothes, put them in like a disposable bag, and then protective gear should be worn by the person providing assistance before rendering that assistance. Okay. The reason is if you who are providing assistance become contaminated by the toxin, you may also absorb those contaminants and may also suffer the same reaction. So ensure that you wear protective gear before offering assistance to the patient. Okay. Generally speaking, unless the agent, the contaminant is highly reactive, it's appropriate to wash the victim thoroughly with water, preferably in a nearby decontamination shower. Wash the person, and water should not be used you know, when the contaminant is highly reactive, okay? So if it's like elemental sodium, phosphorus, calcium oxide, titanium, tetrachloride, I don't use water. But for in most cases, you can use water. When emergency medical personnel arrive on the scene, they should continue the skin decontamination, but it is not advisable that you should be doing skin decontamination for more than 15 minutes. Immediately, you do it sufficiently, transfer the patient to an emergency room. Upon arrival at the healthcare facility, the victim may require quarantine depending on the nature of the agent. Skin decontamination in a decontamination shower can continue within the hospital, but at least within 15 minutes of starting the decontamination on the site, get the person to a hospital. Particular caution should be exercised in decontaminating victims of organophosphate insecticide poisoning. Healthcare personnel who went to offer assistance sometimes who didn't wear the proper protection gear have found themselves also hospitalized due to the effect of organophosphate poisoning because they were not properly protected. So appropriate care should be used. Without exception, toxin-induced skin burns should be treated according to existing burn management guidelines. Okay, which include, of course, wound debridement, dressing, monitoring for infection, fluid management, and surgical consultation when appropriate. Now, how do we eliminate poisons from the GIT? We've talked about the eyes, we've talked about the skin. Now, when the poison is ingested, of course, after ingesting a toxic substance, with the exception of agents that have direct toxic effect on the GIT, for example, iron or corrosive substances, that substance must be systemically absorbed and circulated before it reaches the target organ to exact clinical toxicity. Preventing the absorption of toxin is therefore the foundation of treatment after ingestion of the toxin has occurred. The term GI decontamination has been coined to describe those interventions that are useful in preventing toxin absorption. With the exception of rare interventions such as gastroscopy, GI decontamination is considered to have only three components: gastric evacuation, administration of adsorbents, and catharsis. Gastric evacuation is accomplished through gastric lavage. Syrup of ipecacuanha or syrup of ipeca, once used as an emetic for treatment of toxic ingestions, is no longer routinely recommended for this purpose. One, because it is the process is not really that effective, and then there is the danger of aspiration. Now, there are several agents that can absorb toxic substances, reducing their systemic absorption and subsequent toxicity. Of these, though, charcoal is the most important adsorbent. There are few substances that activated charcoal will not absorb. Some of the agents used as adsorbents include activated charcoal, cholestyramine, sodium phosphosulfonate, fuller's earth, bentonite, starch, potassium ferricyanate. But of these, of course, we said activated charcoal is the most important. Now, there are some substances that are not well absorbed by activated charcoal. For example, alcohols, ethanol, isopropyl alcohol, methanol, glycol, acetone, they are not well absorbed. Hydrocarbons like petroleum distillate, kerosene, plant hydrocarbons, they are not well absorbed by activated charcoal. Metals and inorganic minerals like arsenic, boric acid, fluoride, iron, lead, sodium, corrosive substances like sodium hydroxide, sulfuric or nitric acid, these are not well absorbed by activated charcoal. Okay. Now, catalysis, once an integral part of management, also has played a declining role in the management and treatment of poison patients. So its role is already beginning to diminish significantly. Now, aside from this, there is, of course, antidotes. With the development of sophisticated new antidotes and changing spectrum of clinical poisoning, the use of emergency antidotes is assuming an increasing role in clinical toxicology. Of course, only a few poisons have specific antidotes, but even these, in Nigeria, for example, we do not have an adequate supply of a number of these antidotes. But where they exist, they are very important, and they are usually first line in managing poisoning for their specific toxins. Okay. If you look at the first table, you remember that we had listed some toxins and their specific antidotes. In poisoning with a known substance, early antidotes use is indicated for emergency stabilization, often within the first hour. Hyperbaric oxygen can also provide oxygen at pressure greater than normal atmospheric pressure. And the use of hyperbaric oxygen is becoming standard therapy for patients with significant carbon monoxide poisoning. And of course, it's increasingly being used now for carbon tetrachloride poisoning and in some incidents of cyanide poisoning as well. Admission to an intensive care unit following antidote therapy for further management and observation is generally advised. Now, in some patients who have been exposed, GI exposed to toxins, we can also consider enhanced elimination, especially in patients who you've eliminated some, but the rate of elimination is not fast enough and the damage is ongoing. So you can do something called enhanced elimination of adsorbed substances. Now, there are multiple methods by which this agent in systemic circulation, whether ingested or administered by injection, can be removed. The four most clinically useful means are multiple dose activated charcoal, hemodialysis, hemoperfusion, and urine alkalinization. Now, hemodialysis is useful for removing lithium, ethylene glycol, methanol, salicylate, theophylline, and valproate. Hemoperfusion is useful for removing theophylline and phenobarbital. Alkalinization of urine is useful for phenobarbital and salicylate. Multi-dose activated charcoal is effective, there's evidence for its effect against phenobarbital, theophylline, carbamazepine, salicylate, digitoxin, and dapsone. There is also evidence, but unclear evidence, of its effectiveness in removing anticholinergic or antihistamine agents, sustained release pharmaceuticals, thyroid hormone, and valproate. And there is no evidence of its effectiveness in clearing aminoglycosides, anticholinergic agents, calcium channel blockers, phenothiazine, and tricyclic antidepressants. With that, we'll quickly talk about observation and supportive care following treatment. Observation and supportive care are the mainstay of therapy for the poison patient. Indiscriminate use of gastric lavage, antidotes, and drugs should be avoided. All too often, the toxic agent is unknown. Multiple drugs have been taken, or the patient is too unstable to undergo an aggressive therapy, such as hemodialysis. So monitoring of vital signs, cardiac telemetry, and oxygen saturation monitoring is mandatory. Hospitalization in an intensive care unit is generally indicated for the patient with serious poisoning. If you find a patient with serious poisoning, with symptom complex, for example, multi-system monitoring with blood studies and assessment of other parameters are indicated. And upon detection of any specific system disturbance, appropriate subspecialty consultation is warranted. Some agents such as iron, mercury, paracetamol, CCL4 have a latent phase in which the patient appears to be recovering from the initial toxin only to decompensate within 24 to 72 hours following ingestion. Patients with overdose of sustained release capsules, such as calcium channel blockers or theophylline preparations, also may have delayed manifestation of poisoning. Rarely, you have tricyclic antidepressant poisoning that have been known to cause fatal arrhythmia up to 3 days following ingestion. Some effects are not seen until later, such as hypertension following phenylcyclidine ingestion, hemorrhagic colitis following mercury ingestion, and disseminated intravascular coagulation following snake bite. One must also watch for the delayed pulmonary, hepatic, renal, and hematological manifestation of poisoning. Patients may require observation because of an underlying disease that may be exacerbated because of the overdose. For example, patients with diabetes, congestive heart failure, cardiac rhythm disturbance, or chronic lung disease. Observation may be necessary to evaluate or treat complications, such as in patients with an overdose who fell and sustained trauma, or in a patient who develops aspiration pneumonitis or interstitial pulmonary edema. Patients who use illicit drugs through intravenous route, you may find multiple complications in such patients. Observation is especially indicated for patients experiencing these complications, which include bacterial endocarditis, rhabdomyolysis, and neurologic sequelae. Now let's look at disposition and aftercare. Of course, what do we expect to see in this patient? The disposition of the patient with intoxication may involve medical and psychiatric care, as well as social follow-up. All patients admitted to the hospital with intentional overdose warrant close observation and institution of suicide precautions. This patient may need appropriate restraint or observation if further injury or additional overdose attempts are to be prevented. Overt or subtle attempts or gestures indicate the need for psychiatric evaluation. Often, outpatient follow-up is necessary. For example, a child with kerosene ingestion may require further examination and chest radiography, and a child who has ingested anticoagulant rat poison may require serial outpatient monitoring of prothrombin times. The issue of child abuse or neglect may need consideration whenever a pediatric patient is treated. Finally, long-term follow-up may be indicated. For example, when you check recreational drug abusers who inject drugs, when you check and find out that they have HIV or hepatitis, you may need to follow them up. Long-term, since these complications may also lead to worse outcomes in the end. With this, I'll ask your questions. If you have questions, you can raise your hand to ask or send a mail or send it in the chat area, and then we'll quickly attend to your question. Thanks for listening. God bless you.